like to define what's normal in our population, because the current practice, although the head circumference, the genitalia, the age, the weight of child and the length of child is all reported, however, we do not concentrate on the position of anus and meconium. Pastor and macrophilipu is labeled as having a normal anus, and this leads to missed fistulas. So we wanted the first examining physician to be aware of this indent and to be able to identify it, so that patients can be referred on time and then evaluated and treated accordingly. So with this, we set out on an objective to define the normal anus by using the anal position index. The study was a cross-sectional study conducted over 8 months at the Aha University Hospital. A sample size of 180 was calculated, but we were able to enroll 204 using non-progressivity consecutive sampling. An ethics review committee approval was approved, was taken before the initiation of study. Inclusion criteria included all male and female babies born and marked as having a normal anus by the neonatologist, the first physician coming in contact with the patient. Any ambiguous genitalia or patients or babies that had any associated anomalies with the perineal region were removed from the study. Data was collected using the pre-structured performa, and each value was measured twice using the Ghent technique as shown in the diagram before, and data was analyzed. We had a total of 204 patients equally distributed into male and female. Around 30% were low birth weight and 39% were premature. A few other variables were analyzed for regression analysis further. So the anal position index value that we found was 0.30, which is drastically different from the international literature. It was significantly different in males and females as shown in the pictures and charts. Further correlation analysis reveals that API was significantly affected by gestational age as well as birth weight, and further post hoc analysis identified which groups were different according to WHO classification. So multiple regression analysis was done in terms of consanguinity, maternal comorbidities, and other anthropometric measurements, and this showed that 40.7% variation with a significant R2 value was in gender and gestational age. So we know that there is an ectopic anus documented in literature. We know that this is missed at birth, and we know that API exists. We also know that knowing API will alert the surgeon and neonatologist to further evaluate this child, but we don't know what's normal in our population. This anal position index has been studied against prematurity and birth weight, and some people extrapolated that geographical location has a difference on it, but nobody came up with good sample size in terms of prematurity, low birth weight, and geography. When I looked at it in literature, I found that our values are significantly different from international as well as our colleagues in India and Bangladesh. So we concluded that the normal anal position index value in our population is 0.36 and 0.24 for male and female, and this varies with gender, gestational age, and birth weight, and we can extrapolate that geography has a role in it as well. Determining it will be useful in recognizing it and then early referral for proper treatment, and we recommend that these values should be made for all birth weights and ages at birth and prematurity, so that normograms and centiles can be made and this anomaly given the respect that it deserves. Thank you.
I think again request to all the presenters, please stick to your time.
I think the question is in research near the last of the session. Any question?
What is the technical significance of your data, whatever you are trying to get, because now it can be applied to radiophysical
So when we look at an anus at birth, we need to recognize if it's in a normal location or not. And if we use the centiles reported in international literature, then all our anuses are abnormal, including mine and yours. So what we're trying to achieve with this study is to define a normal anal position in our population, so that people or babies that have an abnormal anus can be referred accordingly. So the reason that we started looking at this was that we were getting 8-year-olds, 12-year-olds, even 22-year-olds with an ectopic anus causing symptoms in megarectum. So it is clinically important. Abhi humne sirf ek normal identify kiya and we plan to follow these patients further for delegations, bowel management program or enrollment for surgical procedures depending upon how symptomatic they come, because literature says that they become symptomatic.
I have a one quick question. You described ectopic tennis on what aspect? Because you need to see the muscles complex. The energy is in the muscle complex.
Yes.
If normally placed, we take it as a normal. So how you categorize it?
So that's the difference between an ectopic anus and a retroperitoneal fistula. Because an ectopic anus looks like an anus, contracts like an anus, and is covered by skin on all edges. However, it's displaced anteriorly, causing an anatomical posterior shelving defect that causes constipation later. So an ectopic anus will look just like a normal anus, just on an abnormal location.
So the next presenter. Mohammad Asad Khan from Dabur Teaching Hospital, Peshawar. Topic of presentation is percutaneous contrast injection in patient with anorectal malformation for localization of distal rectal pouch. Asad Khan.
I'm from Dabur Teaching Hospital, and the title of my study is percutaneous contrast injection in cases of anorectal malformation for localization of distal anorectal pouch. The objective of our study. The objective of our study was to introduce this new technique of blindly injecting contrast into the cases of anorectal malformation, and then to compare those contrast X-rays with the conventional lay cross-table pelvic X-rays for assessing distal limit of colorectal pouch. Now, the procedure that I just mentioned has been standardized through ultrasound studies. We take 3 cc of gastrographin mixed with 7 cc of normal saline in a standard 10 cc disposable syringe. We put the baby in a left lateral position with hip flexor at 90 degrees. Palpate the coccyx or decrease the spine if coccyx is absent, and then through aseptic technique insert the needle in 90 degree to the skin just in front of the coccyx. We progress the needle in parallel fashion to the sacrum and inject all of the contrast. Our one group pre-test, post-test, quasi-experimental study included 21 cases of anorectal malformation. They were all males. And it was started in August 2020 and still ongoing in Khyber Teaching Hospital after ethical approval from Khyber Medical College. The cases were selected by probability consecutive sampling, and we excluded female units, those with anal membrane or perineal fistula, prematurity, clinical instability, or those having peritonitis. What we did was that we received patients of ARM. We sent them immediately to radiology department for plain cross-table X-rays. And upon return from there, we injected them with contrast by the method that I just mentioned and sent them back for contrast X-rays. We evaluated these two X-rays with respect to two variables. Number one, whether or not the colorectum is outlined in front of the sacrum. And number two, the difference between the level of the gas in plain X-rays and the level of the contrast in the second X-ray, and we measured them in terms of vertebral levels that were incremented into the shadow. Now I want all audience to look at this X-ray, the plain X-ray. Do we see a colorectal shadow in this case? This was done before, after 24 hours of birth. No, clearly there is not, and the lowest limit of gas is seen to be at the level of L4 or L5. Now, after injection of the contrast, we can see that there is a remarkable outlining of the colorectum, and not only that, the shadow has been incremented, and now that shadow lies at around the level of the coccyx. Same goes for the second X-ray. We do not see a colorectal outlining in front of the sacrum. And the distal limit of air looks to be quite high. Now, after injection of contrast to the same patient, there's a beautiful outlining of the colorectal shadow, and the level of the contrast appears to be quite low. This was actually the best shot. Based on that X-ray, we were planning for going to colostomy,
But then after injecting contrast, this patient underwent primary TSAR procedure. So the results, in pre-contrast plane, the conventional X-ray, colorectum was only outlined in 28.6% of the cases, in comparison to the contrast X-ray that we did, in which the incidence was 81%. Contrast X-ray, plane X-rays failed to outline most of the cases, and they were got corrected by the post-contrast X-ray in 61% of the cases. Of course, there was some spillage. In 9.5% of the cases, we missed the colon, and there was spillage of gastrography in the peritoneal cavity, but since it's water soluble, so in conclusion, a plain cross-tabular pelvic X-rays poorly localized distal colorectal limit in cases of colorectal malformation of the sensitivity of only 23%. The percutaneous contrast injection not only successfully hits the rectum in 80% of the cases by the method that I just mentioned, but also increments length to the distal limit in 80% of the cases by 4 vertebra. So it can possibly eliminate a 24-hour wait period time, and also many patients will become candidates for primary PSAR. Thank you so much. The idea of this technique was emphasized by Professor Dr. Nagarajan. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
No, sir, it was blind injection. Yes, sir.
How can your ethical view for our institution
for the in a painful condition? It's a painful condition for you then. And you shown the X-ray which are not the cross-table, exactly X-ray in which the as you told that levels are higher as compared to your contrast.
Yes, if you could kindly repeat the PowerPoint and show the answer, sir. We did two cases under ultrasound guidance to just standardize or to just define.
Fluoroscopic
control,
it's just fine.
Sir, fluoroscopy wouldn't have been possible if there is no contrast. We did it.
You are injecting blindly.
Yes, sir. That's what we did.
Doctor, I am sorry to say, we are here to follow you, the youngs. But this technique has been there for the last many decades. To inject contrast and do that, it is a dangerous thing,
yes.
And it has been obsolete now. So please do not recommend this. The youngsters should not take the message home that try to inject a needle with contrast blindly. That 10% of cases it goes into the peritoneal cavity and causes peritonitis.
We are using gastrographic contrast, which is water soluble in very small amount. It is diluted with normal saline.
I think we stop the discussions here. And rather than discouraging, I think what in was when you are doing the repair.
Abdul Fatma from NICH Karachi. The topic of presentation is genetoscopy finding in patient with common caliber and genetic studies.
Dr. Abdul Azam, Dr. Hayatul Iman, Dr. Pavel Tariq Ahmed, Nausheen Anwar, Athal Fazli, Rashid Fayaz Sipah, Javed Jahangir, and Miam Bakhsh, agar wo hain, to niche gaadi mein chale gaye jo ja rahi hai.
Thank you. I am Dr. Badul Fatma from NICH, and the topic of my presentation is genital anomalies in patients with local malformation. The objective was to identify the spectrum of genital tract anomalies in patients with glaucoma malformation As you already know, there is a genital tract anomaly already present, but I'm talking other than that. Okay, it was a retrospective descriptive case series which we conducted from January 2015 till December 2020. It was a retrieval of records of all the patients with Tuchel malformation, and the findings were combined findings from ultrasound, contrast studies, endoscopies, and the definitive surgery. Okay, the results were that we had the patients of common cloaca were 28 patients in this entire time. There were many other patients, but complete records of 28 patients were available that we used in the study. Patients with genital tract anomalies were 20 in number, and without any other genital tract anomalies, we had 8 patients. Out of those 20 patients, 9 of the patients had a single anomaly. There were 2 anomalies in 7 of the patients and more than 2 anomalies in 1 of the patients. The most commonly seen anomaly was a separated vagina, which was present in 8 patients, hydrocarpus in 6, bichondroid uterus in 5, and the rest were very rarely seen. There were some interesting findings that I wanted to mention, apart from the usually seen things. We had a patient with separate vagina who had an extremely enlarged clitoris, which we usually do not see in a patient with a single perineal opening. 2 of our patients who had a rectovesical fistula, one of them had a pouch colon type 1 that was directly opening into the bladder, and she also had uterine atrophy. And another patient with rectovesical fistula had an absent uterus with hydrocarpus. And other patient, there was a normal uterus and a normal vagina with a single ovary. And a patient with a separate vagina had an opening of the rectal fistula on the lateral wall of the vagina, and it was very wide. So basically, the point of this descriptive review of the, of our patients was to know the multiple anomalies that we have in our patients with common cloaca, and that will help us in managing the patient for planning the definitive surgery. And we can refer the patient earlier to a gynecologist, and we can have a multidisciplinary approach. Early referral does not mean early reconstructive surgery. Early referral just means that we can have a multidisciplinary approach. More faculties are involved in the planning of the patient. And the knowledge of these anomalies in the infantile period will help us in counseling the parents regarding the need for surgeries in adult life as well. And we need to restore the sexual and reproductive function of these patients. So this will help in counseling, and our prognosis can be known. And secondly,
any question? We have enough time.
You referred only to gynecologists. Gynecologists do not know how to reconstruct the genital tract, and it is an our experience that they refer back to pediatric surgeon. I am operating the genital anomalies related to genital urinary system after the age of 25. Because the gynecologist does not know how to reconstruct the genital tract. And we 2 times appointed gynecologists in a children's hospital, then they left. And they said, we are unable to deal with the significant because the rectum or the genital, GIT is also associated with this. And they do not know how to handle with the GIT anomalies along with this gynecological anomaly.
Of the anomalies, it can be treated by a pediatric surgeon as well as the gynecologist board. Ideally speaking, it is multidisciplinary. But here, we do it ourselves as well, but our gynecologists, doctors, they also recommend that they do it as well in our setup. Dr. Halima, who was here, we usually refer our patients to her, and she is also keen that we should do it in collaboration as well. We usually do not refer every patient, but once we have done a definitive surgery for the rectum and only the vaginal reconstruction part is left, so they also do it, and they manage the patients as well with common cloaca.
If sometimes needed to reconstruct the vaginal tract by GIT,
what can they help us do? Sir, in most, because it has a very big spectrum of anomalies, so where there is a complex procedure which involves the reproductive and the GIT tract both, it can be done in collaboration, not complete referral. We meant a multidisciplinary approach.
Are there any gynecologists dealing with genitalplasty in the same sitting or later on?
Later on, sir.
Either the premier dissection, massive dissection, you have to call the GI for the reconstruction of the vagina. That is feasible at the same time when you are reconstructing the anus. At the same time, reconstruction of the vagina is very, very easy. Very, very easy. I have performed more than 10 cases of open cloaca. Both are reconstructed at the same time. But when I have to reconstruct the vagina in an elder patient, that is too difficult. That is too difficult.
Sir,
we are pediatric surgeons, are gynecologists, pediatric surgeons, are urologists, pediatric surgeons, are orthopedic. They have to decide what to do. They take the help, but not from the help which have never done anything in a later period. Therefore, you can do each and everything.
Any other questions?
The part of rectum that we need to separate, and the lower confluence we usually manage ourselves, but if a higher confluence and then you try dysphagia, these are the situations we should send them to the particular relevant people that can manage better than us, that we found in our case. Maybe people have got a different experiences, but what we found in our scenario, it's the same.
From PNSC Hospital, Bahia University of Medical and Dental College, Karachi. The topic of presentation is distal loop exclusion with novel technique to avoid divided stoma in retrovascular blood vessel patients.
Assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon, everyone. I'll be today just talking about a very simple technique in which a divided stoma can be converted, loop stoma can be converted into a divided stoma. So the standard teaching so far has been always in the ARA patients is a divided stoma, because the proponents think that a divided stoma is required because it decreases the chances of UTIs in patient, decreases the risk of prolapse and has less chances of parastomal hernia. While the proponents of the loop stoma would say that the loop stoma is easy to construct, it takes less time for construction and the post-operative cosmesis is better in the loop stoma patients. So we carried out a pilot study at PNS Shifa over the last 2 years after taking permission from the ethical review committee. So it included 8 patients, and this study was carried out on all those patients of rectovestibular cases which were operated as staged procedures. So the age ranged from 2 to 4 months. Three cases were operated as a two-stage procedures. In the two-stage procedures, we performed the stoma, and at the same time, we performed the anterior sagittal anorectoplasty. While in the five patients, we had to perform a three-stage procedure in which the stoma was formed initially, then PSARP was carried out, and then as a last stage or a third stage, the stoma was closed. So the technique was very simple. In all the patients, we formed a bridge stoma, and a triangular flap of skin was created with the apex which was directed towards the umbilicus. And the upper part of the sigmoid colon, or just at the end of the descending colon, was brought out on the bridge of skin. Then the stoma was fashioned on this triangular bridge, and after the formation of the stoma, a feeding tube was passed to wash the distal loop. So the distal loop was irrigated and washed thoroughly with the biotin and the normal saline. And after clearing the distal loop, of the gut, a simple single or two silk sutures were applied to close the distal end. Because we assume that in our setups, in the divided stoma patients, the babies are not putting on colostomy bags, and some of the schools still would find their way and trickle down into the distal loop over here and would still be causing problems like UTIs and things like that. So we completely excluded this distal loop. And this, the idea of this exclusion of the distal loop is not a new one. It has been there in the literature and we have been using it as a pyloric exclusion procedures in the complicated duodenal injury cases. So then a SRP was carried out in this child. And this is the another picture of another baby, and this is the time of the closure of the stroma. You can still see that the silk suture is there, which has completely occluded the distal loop and is not letting the stools to go beyond into the distal pouch. So we found out no prolapse, no UTIs, no peristomal hernias, no retraction and necrosis in these children. However, one of the baby developed wound infection, but that got settled down with just the application of dressings and sitz baths. There was no wound, complete wound dehiscence noted in any of these patients. So in the end, I can put this in the cosmetic result of a divided stoma, and this is the loop stoma. In the end, I must conclude by saying that it was a very simple procedure and we performed it on very less number of patients as a pilot study, but it can be done as an RCT in high volume centers. Thank you.
I just have a query that today, nowadays, there is a has to be done in a single stage in rectal vestibular fistula. Why are you doing colostomies nowadays, number one?
Sir, for that...
Number two point is that everybody in the modern society, rich or poor, are using pampers. There is already swelling going on to the to prevent the infection.
So the answer to your first part is we have to look at into the literature, what the literature says. The latest meta-analysis and systematic review which has been published on a single stage or multi-stage procedures was published last year in 2019. And the rate of infection, that meta-analysis and systematic review says that the rate of infection in a single stage cases is 26% and the wound dehiscence is 16%. While in the multi-stage procedures, the rate of infection is only 2.5%, and wound dehiscence was only 2%. So there is a high difference between the stage procedure and the single-stage procedure. So if we look at that, that one is the latest meta-analysis and systematic view that we have available with us.
It basically depends. It's not that all the patients should be harsh or hard. Lower level, I mean, you can go ahead. But if we have deep seated fistula in the vestibule, that should not be done primarily, or again, depend the age and the presentation of the patient. It's not only every female patient should be managed with primary stage.
Yes, no, I totally agree. And it is, we have found, we are also doing single stage procedures, but we just do it in the rectovestibular fistula that we operate as a newborn patients. Because in the newborns, we have found that the vagina is under the influence of the estrogens and progesterones of the mother. The vaginal wall is very thick in the newborn. And it is very, very easy to separate the vagina from the rectum in a newborn baby rather than a 2-month-old or 4-month-old baby. And we also have the facility of TPN in the newborn, so we opt for single-stage procedures in the newborns, but in kids like these who come to us at 2 months, 4 months.
Your time is finished.
Thank you, Dr. Sir. The next presenter is Dr. Fayaz from Radiating Hospital, MTI, Peshawar. The topic of presentation is single-stage repair of ARM in female with vestibular fistula or perineal fistula.
My name is Dr. Fayaz Iqbal and I'm R5 from Radiating Hospital, Peshawar. Today, my topic of presentation is primary PSI female patient with ARM with RVF and perineal fistula. I'll be sharing our experience which we have collected our data in the last 6 months that we did primary PSI for the patient which primarily comes from female patient having rectovestibular fistula and perineal fistula. jumping into the diagnosis, you should examine the perineum, whether how many openings are there. If there is only one opening, which means this is common cloaca, and if there are two openings in the perineum, that would suggest common urogenital sinus. While in our case, we are looking for the cases which are having three perineal openings. First, there is urethral opening, vaginal opening, and the last is a perineal fissure. Whether it is outside the vestibule, and if the fissure is within the vestibule, it means that it is a retrovestibular fissure. We believe that primary PSR for erectile vestibular fissure or perineal fissure causes almost same outcomes as compared to conventional muscle extension procedure. However, it has no stoma-related complication, which are skin excavations or ulceration, relapse or prolapse. It has got better financial relief for the parents and less hospital visits, parental acceptance. It has also got accelerated pathway for healing. There are less or no chances of infection. So this is the methodology. In our last 6 months period, we approximately randomly treated 26 patients, out of which 17 went through conventional multi-stage procedure, while 9 were dead with primary PSR, out of which 8 of the patients were rectovestibular fistula, and while 1 were having perineal fistula. Here you can see that we start our dissection. First of all, retraction is applied, and conventional stage sutures applied for the fistula. Then we start our dissection from the posterior wall, moving to the lateral side, and then separating it anteriorly. We do rectal mobilization, after that vaginal separation. We go for perineal body formation, and then finally anoplasty. Here, same picture again. Sometimes we may come across the rare anomalies like vaginal septum. In that case, we just dissect the vaginal septum and do the vaginoplasty. These are the results which are clear. Outcomes are so promising and so fascinating, you can see in literature. In the end, there is the rectal stoma prolapse, which we are complications of the multi-stage procedure. So I conclude that primary PSR performed less risk post-operative complication. However, this approach is more cost-effective, less burden of hospital, and parental acceptance is more best cosmetic result with good functional outcome, but needs good skill and expertise to proceed. Wide ocean knowledge should be in mind for functional outcomes. Thank you.
Any question?
Question to you,
Jane.
That why you're taking going down. If you do a mini PSRP, what I am doing at my setup in the units, that I do a mini PSRP, I mark the anal position and leave the perineal body as intact, and I ligate the fistula internally. So it will be more good option than that, and you will be an intact perineal body. There will be no wound infection than what we see.
Actually, it's we do for all PSR. Okay, so the main thing is to separate from vagina. If you didn't separate the colon totally, when vagina is dropped, you are in trouble always. Because this patient always have retraction and tension, so you need to separate vagina. You cannot do that interiorly and just like get the fistula and do in a plastic. First for that you need total mobilization.
Not as thick in the numerator age due to how
that it's very thin in the infancy and later on. So you are able to do the there's long series and the Indian Journal of Pediatrics says it's about the there's a meta-analysis of 500 cases of anorectal malformation in girls with the anterior sagittal anorectal plasty.
Okay,
yeah, posterior approach is now recommended and it is standard.
Yes, and I think what Dr. Nasim was saying is a modification of Pannier. If you look at the Pannier original paper, he divides the perineal body, but the later modification avoids dividing the perineal body and go to the fistula from above. So there are, I think, various ways of doing it and all got their own techniques.
Before the practical procedure and after how many days after the surgery you started the oral feeding?
Because
most of the time the stool compromises the anastomosis and any bowel preparation before the procedure?
No
bowel preparation?
No bowel, in female.
No bowel preparation?
No, because female usually they come very early for crying. For stage, they already have stoma, so their colon is empty.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tejas. The next presenter is Sumera Zameen from Lumps Junction Road. Her topic of presentation is outcome of transcatheter ARM with RDA. Sumera.
The topic of my presentation is outcome of transfistula and rectoplasty, the management of rectovascular fistula in females. As we know that embarbotanus with rectovascular fistula is the commonest type of ARM in females, and various surgical procedures are available to treat this condition, including posterior sagittal anorectoplasty and anterior sagittal anorectoplasty. In our center, we have chosen transfistula anorectoplasty to treat this condition, as this requires minimal dissection without the disruption of the perineal body and perineal skin. So the objective of my study is to determine the functional as well as the cosmetic outcome of transfistula anorectoplasty in the management of rectovascular fistula. This was a retrospective study conducted in the Department of the Pediatric Surgery during the period of September 2018 till September 2020. Initially we have started this technique with covering a stoma three-stage procedure, but now we are performing this procedure as a primary procedure also. So data was collecting regarding early complication including wound infection, wound adhesion and skin exfoliation, and data regarding late complication was also collected. Information from the parents was taken whether they are following the validation program or any episodes of soiling or constipation. These are some of the picture of the surgical technique. In first picture, we can see that steel suture was taken around the fistula side. In the second picture, there is a mobilization of the rectum anteriorly up to the cervix and the posteriorly up to the sacrum. This is the placement of the rectum to the external sphincter complex, and the final picture shows that the fistula site is closed with anoplasty done in the proposed anal size with intact perineal body and the perineal skin near to the normal anatomy with good cosmetic results. So total number of patients in our study are 87, and the mean operative time was 45 minutes and average hospital stay was 7 days. Primary procedure was done in less than 1 year of age, and total number of patients were 24 patients. Those who are above 1 year of age, we have performed three-stage procedures. Regarding early complication, out of 87 patients, 17 patients were suffered vaginal tear that was repaired primarily, and skin exfoliation is mainly noted in the primary procedure. None of the patients had wound adhesions. In the late complication, anal stenosis was noted in 13 patients who were lost to follow-up and presented with anal stenosis, and Haggard dilatation program were not following. So they were again admitted and dilatation was done under GA. These are slides showing complication. Functional scoring was done by taking the parent's perspective regarding the voluntary bowel movements per day, episodes of soiling and constipation. And those who have scored greater than 4 were classified as good. Those who have scored 2 to 3 are classified as fair. And those who have less than 1 or less no scorings are classified as poor. So we have 33 patient, number of patients that have a good scoring, and these scoring were done on those patients who are more than 3 years of age or at the age of the voluntary bowel movement control. While those who are less than 1 year of age, we have checked the anal stools with nerve stimulator, and grading was done accordingly. So, transfistula and rectoplasty for the repair of rectovascular fistula is a feasible procedure with few minor treatable complications. The correct placement of the rectum to the external sphincter complex with minimal dissection and keeping the perineum intact and skin intact are the important steps of the surgery. Wound care and with regular dilatation program is essential to prevent anal stenosis and constipation. Thank you.
So many have been listening to other papers as well. And उनकी techniques में और endoplasty में और आपके बारे में आप क्या समझते हैं, क्या recommend? उनको आप लोग देखना, उनके result भी हैं, आपके भी हैं. So how would you compare?
I think I was doing residency, we are usually performing the ASRP procedures. So but now I have joined the center, so I have seen the transfistula and rectoplasty the procedure. But for my until 3 years I have seen good result with ASRP also. So up till now I would say that ASRP or PSRP can be done for this procedure.
Insert a flap tube into the rectum and watch the colon that is spread as clear. Figure number 9 is our simple invention. Solution of iodine and water pump. We ask the weather to flush and spread the plastic wound each time the patient comes. Regarding the research, among 42 patients, 33 were from 2 to 6 months of age, labeled as group A, and 19 were from 6 to 12 months old, labeled as group B. The mean operative time of A was 73.3 minutes and that of group B was 76.02 minutes. Similarly, the mean hospital stay, post-operative hospital stay was 3.32 days in group A and 3 days in group B. There was no such statistical significant difference between these two groups regarding these two variables. Regarding complications in group A, we saw vaginal injury in one patient and wound accidents in two patients. We didn't encounter any such complications in group B. Perineal excoriation was seen in 34% of the patients in group A and 26% patients in group B. We did not experience any wound retraction or fistula events in either of the groups. Regarding these complications, there was no statistically significant difference between the groups. At 3 months follow-up, we saw that the perineal excoriation dropped to 13% in group A and 5.2% in group B. As expected, 43% of the patients in group A and 47% patients in group B experienced constipation. One patient in each group had new anal stenosis and there was no mucosal prolapse. Again, the difference was not significant. Concluding the presentation, primary transmetallic endoplasty is a novel, feasible, and safe surgical option for treatment of rectal vestibular fistula. In first year of life, there is no statistically significant difference in the post and the operative and functional outcome if operated between 2 to 6 or 6 to 12 months of age. The functional outcome, I need to say, the constipation only. With good preoperative and postoperative care, the complications can be kept minimal. Thank you.
Transmetallic
endoplasty.
You are
mobilizing the fistula? We are doing it through the sphincter, keeping yourself confined to the boundaries of the sphincter.
Okay. Fistula will be altered
again. Yes, sir. We dissected, we keep ourselves close to the wall of the rectum, and when we reach the point where it is inserted into the fistula's opening from inside, we transected over there and then tagged it to the suture. We do not do anything with that, we just bust the mucosa and leave it as such, and what happens to that is yet to be known, because we do not take any stitch, because the rate of infections in this area is very high. So we are yet to see what happens to that opening, and we have already consulted our
If you mobilize around that fistula, a little bit of mobilization, don't you think that will be easy for you to transmit people that do endoplasty karini?
By that approach, I think we will be more close to the vaginal wall, and the incidence of injury to the vaginal wall is more as was detected in Mr. Vyas' presentation.
Most of you have questions, and you have a lot of questions. You have a rectovestibular. How do you define a rectovestibular? Was it an endovestibular fistula or a rectovestibular fistula? We do not know at this point in time. You have to have a clarity. Secondly, you have a fistula or a fistula or a fistula? Yes, we have a
fistula. We also do not
know how आपको डर होता है
that is important, but I think from listening to various participant, it seems we are going back to Stephen's approach.
Yes.
Institute of Child Health Lao, topic of presentation is Palliative of surgery done in patients of anatomical malformation presented in New York today.
Assalamualaikum, I am Dr. Aisha Manzoor, 4th year resident from Children's Hospital, Lahore. I am going to present the audit of surgeries done in patients of ARN in neonatal period. The objective of my study was to audit the prevalence of disease, type, outcome of surgeries, gender predominance, associated anomalies, and follow up in these in patients of ARN. This was a retrospective study and conducted over a period of 1 year from January 2020 to January 2021 at Children's Hospital Lahore after the ethical approval from IRP committee of Children's Hospital Lahore. A total of 111 neonates were studied who had undergone colostomy or anaplasty for ARN. The all data was analyzed with SPSS version 23. There was no conflict of interest. The spectrum of clinical presentation of the varieties shows that the high variety ARN was most common presentation and rectocranial cysta was the second most common presentation. In 90.9% of neonates, they presented with the pouch colon, which is quite prevalent. And the surveillance of these neonates shows that anomalies were found in 8% of these newborns, with the renal anomaly being the most common, and the rest of 92% of newborns were healthy otherwise. The 76% of these patients were managed with the sigmoid root colostomy, as the high variety ARN was the most common, and 21% required anaplasty, only 3% required exploration colostomy. And regarding result, the mean age of presentation was 4 days, the mean hospital stay was 4.5 days, and the gender predominance shows the male predominance with the male to female ratio of 4.5 to 1. The outcomes were the 33% they recovered and 9% were expired, 55.9% they lost follow-up, only 0.9% required readmissions for any surgery. Total mortality rate was 9%. Out of that, the 9% only 9% was the peri operative mortality, and 95% was they expired after discharge. The follow-up showed the two main complications: abdominal dissection and stoma prolapse, and which was minimal. And 27% of these kids has even 3 periods, and 60%, almost 60% they lost follow-up. In this series, we found that male predominance and high variety was the most common presentation of ARN. Overall mortality was 9% and with perioperative mortality very low. Follow-up is a serious challenge. Reduced surgery rates were minimal considering the initial clinical conditions they presented. I would like to thank the Professor Mohammed Saleem, my project, and his team. Thank you.
So, if the Peshawar Malik model of university, which is a surprising thing, you have to say 9% spinal, 55% osteo follow-up. So, this is 64%. So, it's not a big group, so you have to get analysis. तो आपने कभी सोचा कि why 50 or 56% patients they never came to follow? इसकी क्या वजह है?
Sir, the main reason we found that the contact number they first given at the first presentation were after when they got contacted but not.
तो क्या हम चोरी करके आए थे main से? बच्चा उनका नहीं था क्या छुपा रहे थे बीच में? हाँ, अभी this is a serious challenge actually. क्योंकि अगर आपको कोई डाटा प्रेजेंट करना है लोग टाइम का भी जिसका भी हो जैसा कि हो या डिफरेंट हो तो उसमें तो आपके पास डेटा ही नहीं है इसमें तो हमें कुछ मिला ही नहीं हम लोग बीते अगर केम लोग के उसके साथ हुआ कि आउटकम का भी हमें पता नहीं एंड द क्वेश्चन स्टिल वुड बी कि वेन योर अदर हॉस्पिटल्स आर परफॉर्मिंग डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ प्रोसीजर वाई आर यू नॉट कंसीडरिंग दैट प्रोसीजर बिकॉज इसमें कुछ भी नहीं था सारे तो इंक्लूडेड थे वैसे तो वेस्टिबुलर फिस्टुला वाले भी था इसके अंदर लेकिन उसका आउट हमें नहीं पता कि उसमें आपने किया है क्योंकि जो सर्जरी जो बताई है उसमें से कोई सर्जरी से रिलेटेड अच्छा कहते हैं सलीम फीमेल आती है तो वेस्टर्नल फैसला के साथ नहीं करते कुछ भी, क्या करते हैं क्या करते हैं उसके साथ एक्टिव वेस्टर्नल
कुछ प्रोसीजर
सर क्लॉज प्लीज
क्लॉज नहीं
I think just coming to your support. I think she is presenting an honest audit of her service, and that indicates a huge number of patients are still done in a stage procedure. I think it will be worthwhile looking at your audit and comparing it with the international audits and see, are we staying in pace with the changing trends or are we staying behind the trends? I think this will be a very worthwhile exercise.
सर इनके इमरजेंसी में पेशेंट लाहौर आए थे, उसके बाद दूसरे हॉस्पिटल चले जाएंगे, बहुत सारे नियर बाय हॉस्पिटल में चले जाएंगे।
नहीं हमारा काम क्या है कि उनका कॉन्टैक्ट नंबर तो रखें, ऐसा नहीं है आज के जमाने में, अब मिल सकते हैं।
Thank you, Dr. Aisham. The next presenter is Obaidullah Khan from Lady Reading Hospital, MTI, Peshawar. The topic of presentation is Transcendent Solution Breakthrough for Hashimoto's Disease.
Left colon is involved, then you have option of laparoscopy or laparotomy. You can more, then you have to do diversion and do stage procedure. Next. So this is my patient in follow. So you can see screen. I usually discharge them very fast. The day they start passing stool transient after transient anastomosis, usually second day or third day I start pain, and they go in third or fourth day. And then follow, you can see this patient are very clean. So nothing, no scar marks. This all our patients done transient and primary. Some patient I have in my study, which was already purpose-built for ostomy, away from the biopsy site, which was transition zone. So in these few cases, I did also transient. So these are some our studies and the bowel management we usually all before the surgery. Next. So in control, yes, only the drawback here I noticed is the frozen biopsy availability. The rest of our things are and then you have to have alternative plan. So if it is long segment or total colonic, so you should keep a plan in your. Thank you very much.
So any questions? One question. Without frozen section?
You can say yes. If it is not available in our province, so you cannot say that I will not do this procedure. Then you are doing a lot of procedures, like for example tumors. You are doing without sending frozen section, that your segment is involved. But in first, we do biopsy first.
You do gentle biopsy.
Yeah.
First. Yeah.
Yeah.
Segment.
Proven.
Any complications?
No.
You will only rely on the contrast study.
Yeah, contrast, and you can see clinically. You can see I take a lot of margins even, and I select the patient on contrast study. Yes, and then if I have problem, I can add laparoscopy to mobilize.
Any problem with continence till now?
No.
And why not to take a biopsy at the time when you are doing a good tool at hand? To take a biopsy at that time and send it to a proper lab to see for any cancers if there is any problem in the future.
Yeah, because we didn't have frozen section.
Not frozen.
Yeah.
If you do a full through and take a biopsy at that time.
Yes, we usually do that thing. We usually send all the specimen for biopsy. After pull through and all through one biopsy, the one we did in anastomosis has again the answer. That's what we just
said. I just would like to respond to Shabbi. If you should be at the frozen section here, then you should be going for colostomies and all those things. Now you are adding so many procedures, anesthesia and everything, and the scar and all the morbidity and maybe associated mortality. And if somebody is relying upon the naked eye examination and going into the definitely right segment and putting it out and then confirming it later on as well, I think he can write an article, do we need frozen section? You can question the utility of frozen section, especially in Hirschsprung disease. Is naked eye examination of dilated segment is as good as. So if you can retrospectively analyze the number of patients, yes, then you can say in resource limited to the setup saying, well, you can opt for, it will actually prevent all the morbidity related to colostomy, mobilization, colostomy dysmetry, colostomy adding, whatever. So I think another
view of looking at. That's what I'm connecting my randomized control with contrast and with proven histopathology post transanal. So I will do that comparison study where that contrast study is really helping if you didn't have frozen section. That one I'm already doing.
I think there is enough literature available that correlates the contrast X-ray findings with histological findings at the end. And even in those studies, the concordance is not more than 60-70% between contrast and the histological finding about the transition zone.
I think so. Two stages. First stage में अगर colostomy हो जाती है उसके साथ अगर frozen biopsy availability हमारे पास नहीं है, we take the medical biopsy. वो जहाँ तक हम ट्रांसिशन जोन सस्पेक्ट करते
हैं वो क्वेश्चन नहीं हो रहा है. क्वेश्चन ये हो रहा है कि इनका सिंगल स्टेज है विदाउट एक ही एनेस्थीसिया में एक ही प्रोसीजर में एक ही आपको आउटकम नजर आ रहा है. तो यू कैन ऑलवेज क्वेश्चन साइंस क्या है, हाइपोथेसिस ही है ना, तो जरूरी तो नहीं कि हम अंग्रेजों को कह दें कोई चले हम अल्टीमेटली हाइपोथेसिस बना सकते हैं। हमारा हाइपोथेसिस ये है, फॉर एग्जांपल वेयर से कि मेरा नेगेटिव एग्जामिनेशन इज एज गुड एज हैविंग फ्रोजन सेक्शन ऑन टेबल बिकॉज़ आई एम मोबिलाइजिंग एंड डायरेक्टली सेगमेंट में वेल अबव द ट्रांजिशन जोन एंड ब्रिंगिंग इट डाउन, खत्म बात। और कल को मैं ये डॉक्यूमेंट कर दूं, अब उनकी स्टडीज क्या है अंग्रेजों की, वो यही काम करते हैं, 100 निकाल लिए, 50 निकाल लिए, 80 निकाल लिए, स्टैटिस्टिक्स में डाला और निकाल के करके पी वैल्यू आ गई, ये कराओ और ये ना कराओ, तो किसी कोई अति बड़ी बात नहीं। और हमने देखा भी आपके तीन प्रेजेंटर ने तीन डिफरेंट चार डिफरेंट तरीके से काम किया और हर एक ने कहा अभी हमारे सज्जाद ने तो बहुत सारी पी वैल्यू लगाई हुई थी रैंडमाइज कंट्रोल ट्रायल किया मतलब, तो वो देखिए हो गया खत्म बात।
Your point is valid. Even if you do stoma without frozen section, then you are aging. Same if you do transcendental. So you do stoma also when you need your frozen section for stoma, is right? That your stoma is well in getting your portion. So if you go transcendental, that thing, you use that mathematics, so it's valid, I think so. There is no question about that.
The next presenter is Sana Mohammad Asam from National Institute of Child Health, Jinnah University, Karachi. Bowel Management Program for Pediatric Functional Constipation.
Myself Sana Mohammad Asam, and I am president. I am the first presenter in this group presentation of Bowel Management Program for different conditions. And my Bowel Management Program is for Pediatric Functional Constipation, which is basically more of a behavioral disorder and is diagnosed when there is no anatomic or physiologic or pathologic reason behind the constipation is found. So our aim of study was to evaluate the effectiveness of a structured bowel management program in pediatric functional constipation. And this bowel management program is different from those of the anorectal malformations and from the Hirschsprung disease because our patients were previously normal and they have a normal anatomy. So we had to emphasize more on the parental education and sensitizing them about the bowel management of sensitizing them about the dietary modification, toilet training, and all this. So after taking the IIRB approval, this study was started in Department of Pediatric Surgery of National Institute of Child Health. This was a prospective study, and all the patients of either age and sex, between 3 to 12 years were included in the study with the diagnosis of idiopathic or functional constipation. And all the children who had a history of anorectal malformation, Hirschsprung's disease, and cephalococcygeal teratoma were excluded from the study. The functional constipation is defined as the idiopathic constipation based on the Rome-Cook criteria in the absence of any organic cause like anatomic, pathologic, or physiologic reason for the constipation. So when we see the patient in PD, we first excluded the organic causes of constipation, and then after when we had confirmation of the functional constipation, we did the fecal disinfection if required by colorectal enemas or manually, and then we divided into two categories, those who were previously toilet trained and those who were not trained till yet. So those who were toilet trained, we started with the dietary modification, toilet training, parental education and oral exercise. And those who were not trained, we started with the phosphate and saline, phosphate or saline enema, and along with the dietary modification, toilet training and oral exercise. And then we assessed for the response clinically and radiologically. If it was effective after 1 week, then we continued with the maintenance and observed and weaned if needed. And if it was not effective, we checked for the treatment adherence, investigated further and referred to other subspecialties if needed. So we found that there were 36 patients between the age of 3 to 5 years, and there were 28 patients between the age of 5 to 12 years. There were 33 patients that were toilet trained previously, and those who were not trained were 31 patients. 27 patients got asymptomatic in less than 3 months.
there were 31 patients who got asymptomatic between 3 to 6 months, and only 6 patients required 6-month treatment for before becoming asymptomatic. So no relapse was seen in 959 patients, and only 5 patients were presented with relapse of symptoms. Here is a 3-year-old boy with a at presentation, his colon was completely fecal loaded, and per rectal or DRE there was hard lesion. And after 2 months of initiation of bowel management program, we can see here there is no fecal loading in the X-ray, and clinically he was well. So we found in our study that up to 90% of the children regain their normal bowel habits within 3 to 6 months of initiation of bowel management. Successful management include thorough parental education and toilet strategies. Children have a better outcome when bilious treatment started early and required close follow-ups. We have several indications of our studies. As we found that a large population of children with the functional constipation were treated with an ineffective therapeutic modality. This demands a sustainable awareness program to educate the medical practitioners as well as the general public. Secondly, screening for the behavioral disorder in these patients should be useful for their therapeutic management. So, multidisciplinary approach is required. Thank you.
Two questions. The variation, the variable of age, you know, age ko age to aapne bata diya, the sex, boys mein zyada tha ya girls mein zyada tha. दूसरा हम एक चीज देखते हैं कि ये बच्चे जो है ये खड़े होके करते हैं. व्हाट इज द रीजन फॉर दैट? मोस्ट ऑफ 80% ऑफ द पेरेंट्स से दैट दे डोंट सिट डाउन बिकॉज़ पुशिंग, यू नो, एवरीबॉडी नोस पुशिंग बैठ के ज्यादा हो सकती है. थर्ड चीज ये कि व्हेन दे कम टू अस दे हैव ऑलरेडी बीन ट्रीटेड बाय पीडियाट्रिशियंस. एंड डू फील लाइक मैं कहते 99% लोगों को डू फील लाइक सम काइंड ऑफ लैब एनिमल्स तो नहीं इतने देते जितना ये मतलब दूसरे पगेटिव्स एंड लैक्सेटिव्स देते. डज इट हेल्प और डज इट इन योर मैनेजमेंट और इट डजंट हेल्प एंड शुड इट बी स्टॉप्ड व्हेन वी स्टार्ट द बाउल मैनेजमेंट बिकॉज पर्सनली आई डोंट पुट देम, यू नो, आई डोंट कंटिन्यू देम ऑन इट. इट्स अ सॉर्ट ऑफ अ फॉल्स डिपेंडेंस. तो तीन सवाल थे, आप उसके जवाब
कॉन्फ्रेंस दे वर इक्वली इन्वॉल्वड. एज डिफरेंशिएशन वाज 5 टू 12. Yes, we broadly categorize into 3 to 5 years and 5 to 12 years because mostly in our setup, toilet training start ho chuki hoti hai within 3 to 5 years, and there were many patients who were previously toilet trained, and because of their behavioral issues, this retentive postures and withholding behaviors, they developed the functional constipation. And what was the third question? There were many children, but most of the children were the babies of working ladies, so they don't get time to for the proper for toilet training, and they were
sawal ye pooch rahi hai ki bacche khade hoke hi kyun bahana karte hain,
because of the hard feces they feel painful for the it is painful for the baby, for the children to pass a hard feces, so they try a retentive posture and they avoid to defecate. It is very painful for them.
Lekin many times when we ask this question to the parents ki aap bacche ko kya toilet seat pe bithate hain, to parents ka jawab hota hai nahi, ye to khud hi chala jata hai, khud hi karta rehta hai, aur baithta hi nahi hai, kyunki isse again the behavior starts out of thing. To wo sa preference pe bhi rehte hain, bahut sare bacche delayed ho jate hain. So they never go through a particular training that is important for the child. So that may be one of the reasons that they are
interested in the pediatric
program.
I think this is a difficult problem, and having such a good follow-up of these patients, that these patients persevered with you for 6 months or a year, is an indication of good counseling and good management.
मेरा क्वेश्चन है कि आपने फंक्शनल कॉन्स्टिपेशन जो लेवल किया है, किस लैब्स के बाद लेवल किया है? कोई थायराइड प्रोफाइल कराते हैं, बायोप्सी कराते हैं, या तो बायोप्सी कराते हैं?
I've excluded all these organic causes of constipation, and then I have labeled them according to the definition, as I told, operational definition, on the basis of Rome 4 criteria and the absence of all the anatomic, physiologic, and pathologic reasons for the constipation.
Suppose a Hodgkin disease, how would you exclude?
We need to
call it segment, how would you exclude?
Sir, history. By history, by then history. Examination, and then for.
History is the main.
History, examination, and radiological findings as well.
Have you done examination under anesthesia before excluding the function of constipation?
No, it was not required because the history was very clear that there is no any cause that is related to any anatomy or physiological reason.
Time is finished. Thank you very
much. We never required it.
Thank you, Dr. Sana. The next presenter is Fatur Fatma from NICH Karachi. Topic is bowel management problem for fecal incontinence in patient admitted for ARN.
Bowel management program for patients with anorectal malformation. So my objective was that the bowel management program is a very well-defined entity which is used in more in foreign countries, and it is a one-week boot camp program that they run. But looking at our setups, we found that it was not practically so suitable for us. So my objective was to evaluate the effectiveness of a bowel management program that was somehow modified according to our requirements, and then we saw the effectiveness in terms of the improvement in creatine bed scores. So it was a prospective observational study. We followed it case by case. Started it in July 2020 and still following the patients. Many patients have completed this program and are on regular follow-up without much changes, and others are still being followed. The inclusion criteria was that all the patients of anorectal malformation, they were included in this study when all the stages were complete, and the last stage was done 6 months back. And the age of going for this bowel management program was after 3 years when we have toilet trained and made the patient diaper free. So this is when we start this management program. Before that, we can just keep the patient on fixatives and whatever, but we cannot actually know about the functional, about the voluntary bowel movements and anything once the baby is out of the diaper. So we have done modifications in that bootcamp program. In the evaluation of such patients, they start with contrast studies and EUA. But it is not very feasible in our OPD where we have so much influx and a ward which is so busy. We have evaluated on the basis of plain abdominal x-rays and a simple GRE. Because I am here only dealing with ARM patients, but this bowel management program which is run in other countries, it also includes Hirschsprung patients and patients with neurological diseases. So we do not have, we have a certain set of patients that we have to follow. So this X-ray and the DRE, it helps in counseling the patients for the prognosis of the program. Some have very good prognosis, they respond very well, they respond very early, others will respond late and might not have such good results. So after evaluation, we start with the quantity and type of wash. This is somehow similar. We start with 10 to 20 ml per kg of saline, then we add glycerin if we are not able to regulate the function, and if it is causing bowel cramps or abdominal pain, then we can switch to castile soap or a baby shampoo, which is also very effective. So addition of laxative is plus minus depending on how we want to regulate the cycle. Usually we use stimulant laxatives so that we can have a bowel movement once a day or twice a day according to the patient. So we have not followed the patient for one complete week. We have kept the patient on fortnightly follow-up. Once we have given them a program to start, we follow them after 15 days and then we change the quantity and the type if needed. So the end point of our quantity and the type was dependent on when the abdominal x-ray was clear, there was no fecal loading and there were no exudates. Exudates are basically the time a patient soils their clothes. So these are the modifications that are listed here, and I have already told them. And they also have a very good psychosocial program.
They counsel the school teachers, students, everybody knows what we have to do when such patient has accident and how to deal with such patients, but we do not have a such good contact here with the patients that we can follow them at school, because not every patient belongs to our vicinity, they come from other cities as well. So instead of that, we counsel them over phone, keep a communication with the patient over phone. If they have some problem at home, they can talk to the principal investigator, which in this case was me. So we used to counsel them and allotted them a particular time that they can have their queries at this time, and we will respond to them. So these are my results. A total of 30 patients have a routine now, and others are still on follow-up trying to develop a routine. Out of them, 16 were male and 14 were female. The age groups were 3 to 5. Mostly the patients are in this category. This is the age when the parents have to do it. And the rest of the age group, more than 8 years of age, the patient is himself willing to do it because they want to be socially accepted. These are the types of malformation. So this is the main score. I have seen that there was improvement in my patients. We can see in the green lines that they have a very high score of Frickenbeck, and which was improved after running this bowel management program. So the mean of 5.5 was converted into 3.77, which was significant. So I conclude that my modifications were significant and they can be used. Thank you.
Thank you. So any quick questions? Very nice study, by the way, because bowel management is one of the leading here. You can see multiple.
The question is, you said can it be seen if not responding to the maximum dose of saline?
Yes.
While the book says always add stimulant with a dose of 10% of the normal saline. So, did you modify this or you are following some guideline?
No, this is not a modification. I have come to multiple webinars and there are studies. Listerine is not primarily included all the time. So I did not start Listerine as such.
And your goal was to remain clean for 24 hours?
Yes, but I would like to add one point that it's very easy to say that you want to keep the patient clean for 24 hours, but it's not always possible. Sometimes most of the patients, they needed to wash themselves twice a day as well. So this is, and sometimes the few of the patients, they could even skip a day. They were able to wash their feet. So I think that I have managed lots of patients, 40 more patients are still on my follow-up. So it's not always what the book says or what other studies says. We can always have our own experience with that.
So you advise some EMAs and then the patient goes home?
Yes.
You don't admit the patient for 7 days, as the book says that you tap the patient for 7 days and then increase the EMA and accordingly manage the patient.
It is the most commonly dead part of our pediatric surgery, but and most of the patients are incontinent somehow or the other. Not all the patients are do not have the good scores of continence. So we cannot admit so many patients and run a program. We have doubling and tripling on the bed, so it's not so easy to do it.
Yes, we are running this program in Children Hospital as well, and we have a success rate of almost 95% with the 24 hours cleanliness and with no accidents. And it's very good program, we think.
And do you follow up?
Yes.
You keep a 7 days boot camp?
No, no. So the question would be, I think the kitab kya kehti hai? What you can do for your patient, the context is become very important. So in your context, if something is working, then you discuss sharing, and it's important you document it and question the admission for 7 days or 8 days. Okay, so that will be good addition to the literature. Thank you.
I would like to add one thing.
Actually, I have a question.
Actually, I will not comment. We have 7 days for management program, but we keep it in McDonald's houses. So no need to admit, you can keep
it. I have a question. The madam said that they don't do the EUS before starting the bowel management program. So how can you know that the patient doesn't need a re-operation or a redo surgery if the sphincter is lying outside?
DRE is a very good predictor of that. When we do a DRE, we are able to comment whether the patient is having a good tone of the anus, it's normal or it's lax. It's a very good predictor. Plus, EUA has been somehow done earlier or later after the surgery. So this was not a part of program. Not every patient who was coming to me, because actually there are a lot of patients who complain of incontinence. We do not admit them for EUAs until needed otherwise. Like if I have a finding in my DRE that wants me to do an EUA and I'm not satisfied with that, obviously we'll go with an EUA. Most of the patients who had a right sphincter or whose dilatations were not appropriate, we once put them on the dilatation program first, or we went for enoplasties like Henneke Macaulay's, we also have done that. So there are a lot of other things that we have done before going to.
Thank you, Dr. Madhulu. The next presenter is Ahmed Aziz Ahmed Chhatra from Tilton Hospital and Institute of Jai and Lao. The effectiveness of the bowel management program and treatment of the post-operative fecal incontinence in patients with ARL and Hodgkin disease. Dr. Ahmed Aziz.
Assalamu alaikum everybody. I am Dr. Aziz from Children's Hospital, Lahore. I am here to present my topic on effectiveness of bowel management program in the treatment of post-operative fecal incontinence in patients of intestinal malformation and Hirschsprung disease. So as we all know that fecal incontinence is a physically and psychologically debilitating condition which impacts not only the patient but the whole family. About 25% patients of intestinal malformation and less than 5% with Hirschsprung disease suffer from fecal incontinence postoperatively. So the objective of the study is to determine the effectiveness of my bowel management program in treating the postoperative fecal incontinence in terms of improvement in the Cleveland fecal incontinence score. So this is a descriptive case series done from January 2020 to February 2021. It's still going on at Children's Hospital, Lahore. The children having fecal incontinence after surgeries of intestinal malformation and Hirschsprung disease age 4 to 18 were included in the study, whereas those patients who had incontinence not related to the primary disease or who required re-operations were excluded from the study. A total of 40 patients were included using non-priority conceptive sampling. Institutional review board approval was taken, age, gender, diagnosis, Cleveland score before starting the bowel management program and after 3 months was studied, and the statistical analysis was done using SPSS 23. Complete medical review of all the patients was done because they were not only the patients who had earlier operations at Children's Hospital but also referred from other institutions. And the daily dose of enema was calculated on by hit and trial method over a period of 1 week based on the clinical response of the patients and the stool distribution which was seen by the serum exchange which were done while the patient was in the hospital. So I have one point, some of these patients who were from far away areas, they were admitted for the whole 1 week. And whereas those who were from nearby like Lahore or the periphery, they were treated on the OPD basis. So out of 40 patients, 35 had surgeries for the anorectal malformation, out of which 27 were male and 8 were female. And the remaining 5 had surgery for Hirschsprung disease, out of which 4 were male, 3 male and 1 was female. So this is the result of my study. The graph here shows the longer bar shows the treatment score before starting the program. The Cleveland score is an incontinence score which ranges from 0 to 20, the 20 being the maximum score showing the patient is fully incontinent and 0 shows the patient is fully continent. So these longer bars shows the Cleveland score before starting the program, whereas these shorter bars shows the Cleveland score after 3 months of bowel management program. So the mean Cleveland score before starting the bowel management program was 17.43 with a standard deviation of 3.63, whereas after 3 months the mean Cleveland score was 1.50, the standard deviation of 2.051. So the p-value was less than 0.001 and it was done using Wilcoxon signed reactors. So to conclude my study, bowel management program is effective in the treatment of fecal incontinence given in children with anatomical etiologies like postoperative basis of intestinal malformation and Hirschsprung disease. Thank you, sir.
We will move fast. Just one question, quick question. Anybody? Just one question.
The next presenter is Hafiz Mahmoud, Hafiz Mahmoud Adnan from Tilton Hospital and Institute of Child and Lao. We contrast enema solving diagnostic enemas in newborn with lower intestinal obstruction.
The role of contrast enema in solving diagnostic dilemmas in neonatal with lower intestinal obstruction. Well, the neonatal intestinal obstruction is a common surgical emergency, but sometimes it is challenging to exactly diagnose the etiology.
it can be either proximal obstruction or it can be a distal obstruction involving the distal ileum, colon or rectosigmoid area. The UTE presents with abdominal distension, bilious vomiting and failure to pass the formula. The common etiologies include intestinal atresia, Hirschsprung disease, meconium ileus, small left colon syndrome and meconium plugs. Our objective was to evaluate the diagnostic efficacy of candidiasisanemia in relevance to clinical findings, imaging characteristics and the final diagnosis of neonatal intestinal obstruction. These etiologies can be managed with less extensive surgeries or even conservatively if diagnosed accurately. And the candidiasisanemia can be helpful to exactly diagnose these etiologies. It was a prospective study over a period of 4 months and total 34 patients were included. Median age of presentation was 3 days and the male to female ratio was 1.7 to 1. Our inclusion criteria include the neonates presenting with abdominal distension, bilious vomiting, failure to pass meconium with ambiguity in diagnosis. And the patients, sick-looking patients with 10th shiny abdomen were excluded. And the standard protocol of gastrograph and pentasoma was followed in all these patients. And these were the X-rays. And this is the X-ray of a patient with Hirschsprung disease. And the transition zone can be seen at the level of the shiny colon. And in this X-ray at the level of sigmoid. And pre-contrast X-ray of FIGL atresia. And post-contrast X-ray when indicating the unused small colon and the ileum and the cut of region. An X-ray of meconium ileus, pre-contrast X-ray and the post-contrast X-ray showing the negative shadows up to the ICJ. And the pre-contrast and the post-contrast X-ray of small left colon. Regarding the results, the contrast of NEMA was sensitive up to 91% of the cases accurately diagnosing the etiology. And the main etiology in our study was Hirschsprung disease. 16 patients followed by meconium ileus and then the IVL atresia. To specify, the contrast anemia was specific regarding Hirschsprung up to 94% and in meconium ileus its specificity was up to 81% and in intestinal atresia and small left colon it was accurate up to 100%. So where it helped us? In 8 patients, our initial diagnosis was intestinal obstruction and plan of management was exploratory laparotomy. While the post-contrast, our plan totally changed and these patients of meconium ileus were managed conservatively. Similarly, in 6 patients of Hirschsprung disease, our plan was exploratory laparotomy for long segment Hirschsprung disease, but post-contrast diagnosis was short segment Hirschsprung and we managed them with sigmoidal colostomy. In 7 patients, our post-contrast diagnosis was ultra-short segment and short segment Hirschsprung and we managed them conservatively for primary procedure. And the one patient of small left colon was also managed similarly conservatively. So these bars are showing the initial, blue bar is showing the initial surgical plan that was reduced to the half. The gray bar is showing the patient managed conservatively and the half of the patients were managed operatively. Similarly, in Hirschsprung disease, the half of the patients were managed conservatively for primary procedure and in meconium ileus, significant reduction in surgical intervention was observed after contrast study and only one patient needed surgery. So the post-contrast diagnosis reduced our surgical burden up to the 47% in this study. To conclude, the contrastanemia is a good diagnostic tool to rule out potential surgical etiologies and help in correct diagnosis. It can also help in planning our management and can prevent neonates from preventable exploration. Thank you.
Okay, a quick question. Can you ask one question?
जब आप लोग ने एसिस्टेंट भेजे हर एक आगे प्रोफेसर लगाया हुआ भाई प्रोफेसर नहीं लगाते जब प्रेजेंटेशन होती है सब नाम लिखना होता है डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर नहीं लगाना होता है जिसने प्रेजेंटेशन नहीं करनी उसका नाम सबसे पहले डाला हुआ है और हम 8-10 नामों में ढूंढ रहे हैं कि अंडरलाइन इसको किया किसी में अंडरलाइन नहीं किया हुआ है तो प्लीज एक तो इसको आप पैटर्न को देखिए आपके हर्ष के आपके स्पेलिंग में एस मिसिंग है हर जगह
किसी चीज का पूछ रहा हूँ क्या आप ये दिस इज स्टैंडर्ड रिकमेंडेशन इट हैज बीन अ स्टैंडर्ड रिकमेंडेशन टू गो फॉर कंट्रास्ट एनिमा इन पेशेंट वेयर जो सस्पेक्टिंग जो आई एम सजेस्ट फॉर दे कैन बी सो दिस इज स्टैंडर्ड थिंग है सो यू आर नॉट फॉलोइंग दैट प्रीवियसली और यू आर थिंक दिस इज समथिंग न्यू दैट यू आर एडिंग टू योर प्रोटोकॉल्स
Sir, initially we were in the new nets with the intersection and we used not used to do the contrast studies in all these new nets where we were not sure about the diagnosis. And we started this in the last year and these...
This is already in the protocol, standardized. Hai. वो किसी लिमिटेशन की वजह से अगर नहीं कराया जा रहा हो तो बात दूसरी कुछ चीज़ों को आपने क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन भी यू कैन रूल आउट फॉर एग्जांपल अगर हर्षमन के आपका डिजिटल एग्जामिनेशन अगर हो रहा है किसी सॉफ्ट ट्यूब से तो मैंने आपका डायग्नोसिस बदल जाता है मीगोनियम ब्लड सिंड्रोम है वो भी निकल जाता है बीच में बहुत ज़्यादा भी डॉक्टर खा लेते हैं उसने किया तो उसमें क्या डिफरेंट चीज़ थी सो येस यू कैन हैव समथिंग एक्सक्लूडेड ऑन योर क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन एंड समथिंग यू कैन हैव एक्सरे And then आपने एक में लिखा अल्ट्रा शॉर्ट सेगमेंट बेसिकली तो मैंने वीकली में डायग्नोसिस होती है तो वो उसमें इस तरह तो नहीं रेडियोलॉजी तो उसको एक्सक्लूड नहीं करती उसका डायग्नोस्टिक क्राइटेरिया सभी चीज़ें ऐड कर
First explanation of the underlining of the first presenter has been done if and some it is missed I don't know, but definitely it was an intention to confuse the organizers. And secondly, regarding the performance of the contrast enema recently, it's not like that. As Dr. Dan has shared that in all of the intestinal obstructions, especially the new nets who were like critical and with the acute signs of obstruction, it wasn't. And formal correlation was not used to be done in statistical terms. So that's why to tune the trainees regarding this established fact and to realize the further importance it has been advised and it's starting to be noted. So that's why we share this step.
Now, audit of neurotic surgeries for intestinal disease.
Assalamualaikum, I'm Dr. Nausheen Ilyas from Children's Hospital, Lahore, and I'm going to present my study, the effect of sucking lollipop on the recovery of genitive function in children with trauma reward. The pattern of my study is traditionally would prohibit oral feeding till return of normal bowel activity after colorectal surgery. But this may result in post-op IBS, leading to abdominal distension, pain, nausea, vomiting, and delayed return of functionality, ultimately leading to delayed post-op recovery to doctor
hospitalization and
financial burden. Many interventional strategies such as prophylactic agents, epidural anesthesia,
Dr. Nausheen, I am interrupting you, Dr. Nausheen.
But most of them have
पूजा कुमारी रेजिडेंट चीफ रेजिडेंट पीडियाट्रिक सर्जरी एट जैपन नेशनल हॉस्पिटल कराची एंड द टाइटल ऑफ माय प्रेजेंटेशन इज रोल ऑफ अल्ट्रासाउंड इन द डायग्नोसिस ऑफ एपेंडिसाइटिस इन चिल्ड्रन So the objective of my study was to determine the accuracy of ultrasound in the diagnosis of acute appendicitis in children taking histopathology as a gold standard. So this was a prospective cross-sectional study and it was conducted in pediatric surgery and emergency department of Liaquat National Hospital. And patients fulfilling the inclusion criteria were included in the study between 1st January 2019 to 15th January 2021. A total of 110 patients were included in the study and non-probability consecutive sampling technique was used. And the inclusion criteria were that patients less than 16 years of age presenting with signs and symptoms of acute appendicitis in whom the ultrasound examination was performed and they underwent appendectomy, they were included. While incidental and interval appendectomies were excluded. So ultrasound was considered positive if a non-compressible, immobile, blind-ended structure wall with the greatest maximal diameter of 6 mm was visualized by the ultrasonographer or he or she could appreciate the secondary sense like dilated small bowel hooks, free fluid collection and fat standing. And the ultrasound was dubbed negative when there was non-visualization of appendix with no other secondary signs. So patient's data including age, sex, duration of pain, clinical examination findings, ultrasound findings and histopathology results were calculated, were recorded, and pre-operative ultrasound findings were compared with post-operative histopathology results, and with that sensitivity, specificity, positive predictive value, negative predictive value and diagnostic accuracy of ultrasound was calculated. So this was the next one. Next, please. So, the analysis is that there were more male patients in our study than female patients, and in 110 patients where ultrasound examination was performed, 93 of the patients had positive ultrasound examinations, while 17 had negative ultrasound examinations. And in these 93, 81 were positive. That means they were directly visualized by the ultrasonographer, while in 12 patients, secondary signs were present. And when these appendices were sent for histopathology, 1 or 2 patients were positive on histopathology, while 8 patients were negative on histopathology. And in these patients where histopathology was negative, ultrasound was positive in 3 cases, while it was negative in 5 cases. And the second last chart that's showing ultrasound, in 17 cases where the ultrasound was negative, histopathology was also negative in 5 cases, while it was positive in 12 cases. So with these results, sensitivity of ultrasound came out to be 88.2%, and the positive predictive value of 96.7% and accuracy of 85.4%, while the ultrasound examination in our study had specificity of 50% and negative predictive value of 25%. So ultrasound is, though in our study it came out to be highly sensitive test, but the negative ultrasound examination cannot completely rule out the diagnosis of acute appendicitis. Though ultrasound is a good modality of choice, it's a non-invasive and easily available test, and it's operator dependent. So whenever a clinician is suspecting acute appendicitis and ultrasound is negative and he had a strong suspicion, he should opt for other investigations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I did my randomized study and the topic was the same. Cross-sectional study on appendicitis. We have 226 patients, I think so. Our accuracy was more good, 94%, I think. So very nice study, by the way. Any questions? This published in N1 of Surgery. You can search.
Okay, thank you, sir.
The next presenter is Asad Amir, Children's Hospital and Institute of Child at Lahore. Comparison of the outcome persisting versus conventional linear wound closure technique in patient undergoing histomalacus.
I am Asad Amir for doing my study. I am the resident of Children's Hospital Lahore and I am doing surgery. I am going to present my study. The title of my study is Comparison of Outcome of Bursting versus Conventional Wound Closure Technique in the Patients Undergoing Histomalacus. The objective of my study is to compare the outcome of bursting versus conventional wound closure technique in the patients undergoing histomalacus.
Doctor, sir, please start your presentation. We can only see your first slide.
The title of my study is Comparison of Outcome of Bursting versus Conventional Wound Closure Technique in the Patients Undergoing Histomalacus. As we know, the stoma formation is the common technique routine in the pediatric surgery, and there are a lot of indications of stoma formation, and all these needs to be versed when it is indicated. We do stoma formation in erectile malformation and perforation, intersections, perforated appendage, and all these needs to be versed when there is indication of reversal. But after reversal of stoma, there is a big challenge of surgical site infection and cosmesis. Routinely, we use a linear wound cure technique that is being used all over the country. But I use in my study the pursing wound cure technique. I close the wound by pursing method. In methodology, the study design is the randomized control trial with this duration of 12 months in Federal Surgical Hospital Lahore that is approved from the IRB of Children Hospital Lahore and the Advanced Review Board of Ministry of Health Sciences Lahore. The sample of my study is 124 and 6 group. I divided the patients group A linear wound cure technique and the group B is pursing wound cure technique. The outcome measured the surgical site infection and I assessed the surgical site infection by the American Guidelines Center of Disease Control and Management that I divided the infection in the superficial heap and organ space. And second, my variable is scar assessment and assess the scar. Here is the stoma formation according to the disease. 40 patients I have taken, total patients were 80, 14 age group. In ARM, 40 patients, you can see in the whole graph. And I assess the scar by the Manchester assessment score. Lesser will be the score, good will be the scar, and greater will be the score, and poor will be the scar. Here are the results you can see, total age in the years, and the sex distribution, male to female ratio, and the size of the eye have equally selected the bone, size of the bone, so that you compare the bone in both groups. And you can see the result, the surgical site infection, you can see that is significantly higher in the group A, and cosmetic effect is significantly good effects in the pursing wound cure technique and low surgical site infection in the group B. You can see that in the picture. In the group A, there is linear wound cure technique and you can see the scar, and I follow the patient after 90 days for scar, and for surgical site infection, it was 30 days ago. You can see in the graph, in the group A, 9 patients infected, and in the group B, there is 3 patients having surgical site infection. And you can see Manchester assessment scar, yellow showing good scar, and the green pair, and 8 patient red showing poor scar. Conclusion of my study, the first stream wound cure technique has better outcomes over the conventional wound cure technique, and having lower surgical site infection, and comparatively having good scar in the first stream wound cure technique. Thank you.
I wonder how you compare wound infection between the two, because it's just the closure of the technique that you are actually discussing.
Yes, sir. I have selected a scale that if the wound is in the size limit of 6 centimeter in each group, then I will compare the both size of the wound per scar assessment.
My question is different. Your wound infection, you said they are quite different in two different techniques. I would like to know the reason why do you think the linear wound were affected more in comparison with the one that took a
closure? Yes, sir.
Why? What could be the reason for that?
The reason is that in the first wound cutting, there is a hole with the size of 2 mm that remains open, and that we do the dissection, the ooze came out through it, and it provides drainage of the serous fluid that was not collected in the wound, and it prevents the wound from further dual collection.
After the linear wound be interrupted, such as a close end. After linear wound be interrupted, such as a close end, there will be a gap.
No, sir, that is, there is no gap in the linear wound cure technique, that is completely, stitches in an interpretive fashion, and there is no gap in it, with approximated margins in it.
Okay. ओके
Just a brief introduction of my study. As you all know, that the acute appendicitis is one of the most surgical conditions that we encounter. The gold standard treatment has remained appendectomy. However, in the current era of the COVID-19, it's frequently presenting disease. So the chance of infection is very high. The people now seriously started considering the non-operative management of acute appendicitis, which had a question mark in the past, and the people decided to go the non-operative management. So we keep this in our mind to change our protocol and manage uncomplicated appendicitis non-operatively to minimize the risk of exposure, limited the utilization of the operation theater and resources. See, the objective of my study to determine the outcome of the non-operative management of acute appendicitis in COVID era. So here I'm sharing our data. The study design is a prospective, descriptive, cross-sectional study. The duration of the study is 9 months from April 2020 to December 2020. Inclusion criteria included all male and female patients with history and clinical sign, and lab parameter was TLC, neutrophil, and ultrasound findings suggested that the patient having uncomplicated appendicitis. In exclusion criteria, we excluded those patients which have been complicated appendicitis like appendicular perforation, abscess, lump, and fecal. The sample size was 105 patients. The variable we used the demography, duration of the symptom, ultrasound finding, clinical improvement or due deterioration, length of the hospital stay, and failure of the non-operative management. The total number of the patient 125. Study explained and informed consent were taken from the parent. Inclusion and exclusion criteria were checked. In these 125 patients, 20 patients had complicated appendicitis, so the appendectomy were done. And 105 patients were managed non-operatively. We gave this patient nut by mouth and IV fluid and antibiotic. We used the third generation cephalosporin like acefotaxime, 100 mg per kg, and metronidazole, 30 mg per kg by divided dose. And regular clinical review after 6 hours to 24 hours. In these 105 patients, 29 patients deteriorated, so we do appendectomy 29 patients, and 79 patients were managed non-operatively, and these patients were stable, and start oral liquid, then establish the semi-solid. And follow up these patients, and discharge this patient with oral antibiotic, and follow up after 1 week. In these 79 patients, 3 patients had recurrence and appendectomy were done. So we managed 76 patients non-operatively in follow over 2 months and had no recurrence. So we assumed that these patients had recovered. So the mean age of our patient 9.41 to 2.65. 77 patients were male and 28 patients were female. In these 77 patients, 50 patients were managed non-operatively and 22 patients deteriorated and appendectomy were done. And 21 female patients were managed non-operatively and 7 patients deteriorated, so appendectomy were done. So we compare duration of the symptom. 61 patient present within 24 hours. In these 61 patient, 50 patient managed non-operatively and 11 patient deteriorated, so appendectomy were done. 41 patient present after 24 hours. In these 44 patient, 26 patient managed non-operatively and 11 patient deteriorated, so appendectomy were done. So we concluded that the majority of our patient was improved. So we concluded that in COVID-19 era, the most non-operative management of acute appendicitis is very effective. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just one quick question.
What antibiotics do you use?
We continue.
Thank you, Dr. Uttarwar. The next presenter is Mamunullah, King Edward University, Mayo Hospital, Lahore. Non-operative treatment with antibiotics and surgery.
Thank you, sir. Please show me your slide.
find Dr. Mamoona visited a periodic searching hospital Lahore. So, a title of my study is non-operative treatment versus affective for acute uncomplicated appendicitis. That's a randomized controlled trial. So the objective was to compare the outcome of non-operative versus surgical management of uncomplicated appendicitis in children. The rationale of our study was that limited local clinical trial is available regarding the efficacy of non-operative treatment with antibiotics, and we want its efficacy in our population. It's a randomized controlled trial with 10-month durations from September 2018 to July 2019 in the Department of Pediatric Surgery, West Lahore. All children from 4 to 12 years of age admitted in pediatric surgery emergency with uncomplicated appendicitis were included, and patients with suspicion of perforator appendicitis, appendicular mass, previous non-operative treatment, and previous abdominal surgery were excluded. Total sample size was 180 and 90 in each group. All patients post feeding exacerbatory were managed non-operatively by keeping NPU for 48 hours, intravenous fluid, IV antibiotics, injection meropenem, 10 mg per kg per dose in 3 divided doses with metronidazole, 20 mg per kg per day in 3 divided doses for at least 48 hours. Once patients started tolerating, it was followed by the ciprofloxacin, 20 mg per kg per day in 3 divided doses with metronidazole, 20 mg per kg per day for another 8 days. Total patients were 180, there were 123, mean 68.3% boys and 58.31.7% girls in the study. Mean and stator deviations are given in table 1. Age in years 9.56 plus minus 1.82 in group A, 10.11 plus minus 1.83 in group B. Duration of symptoms in hours 21.68 plus minus 10.6 in group A, 18.98 plus minus 11.82 in group B. Temperature 99.84 plus minus 1.09 in group A, 99.87 plus minus 1.28 in group B. TLC count 11,300, 11.11 plus minus 2,696.8 in group A, and 11,322.22 plus minus 2,697 in group B. Neutrophil count 63.87 plus minus 13.06 in group A, and 63.53 plus minus 13.02 in group B. NCRP count 7.7 plus minus 1.8 in group A, and 7 plus 7 9 plus minus 1.75 in group B. Pediatric appendicitis score 7.74 plus minus 0.9 in group A, and 7.79 plus minus 0.92 in group B. Weight in kg 17.52 plus minus 4.62 in group A, and 18.47 plus minus 5.11 in group B. So success rate of our study was recorded 83.3% in group A, whereas 100% in group B. Failure of non-operative treatment was in 15, seen in 15 patients, 5 needed appendectomy within 48 hours, while 10 patients presented within 6 months. Mean difference of TLC and CRP was statistically significant. So, conclusion of my study is success rate of non-operative treatment in our study was 84%. So non-operative treatment is in uncomplicated appendicitis can be considered as one of the treatment modality for acute appendicitis in children.
Thank you very much.
So,
any question?
If patient presented to us within 48 hours, if pediatric appendicitis score is equal to 7 or more than 7, if there is no any findings of excess formation, periappendiceal fluid in ultrasonography, we can include in this study, we can manage this patient on a
particular basis. The question is, you have admitted a patient on non-conservative basis.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you will go for the surgery, if that particular patient you have admitted for the surgery,
If patient presented to us after 48 hours, if TLC count in CRP is more significant.
I feel, sir,
I'm assistant professor of
genetics. Firstly, तो बेटा, I don't think you need to have the randomized controlled trial. उसमें तो आपने कहा 100% result है. इसमें जब going in 100% से हम ये समझे कि negative या predictive नहीं है. ये कहना चाह रहे हो? ये कह रहे हो?
84%.
Negative answer. Negative answer. आपने कहा ना दूसरे जिसमें operate किया intervention, आपने randomized controlled trial किया. तो आपका research question क्या था? Hypothesis क्या है? आपने आम बनाया है तो हमें समझ नहीं आया कि उस आम की यूटिलिटी क्या हुई. फिर आपके जो क्लिनिकल पैरामीटर्स हैं ये सारा न्यूट्रोफिल्स एंड एवरीथिंग में से वो तो डायग्नोस्टिक क्राइटेरिया में भी कि आपको इंक्लूजन क्राइटेरिया की बात कर रहे हैं तो उसमें तो हमें कोई इशू नहीं. वो दोनों ग्रुप्स में एक ही तरह का होना चाहिए ताकि वो स्टैंडर्डाइज होता हो तो उसका कोई इशू नहीं है. फिर आपने मेरोपेनम एंटीबायोटिक इस्तेमाल की है एज ए प्राइमरी मेडिसिन जो हम समझते हैं कि वो आपने क्यों उसके लिए पीछे बिहाइंड रीजन क्या है इज सच ए कॉस्टली एंड पर्टिकुलर इंडिकेशन के लिए है. तो मेरोपेनम अगर आप इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं और उसमें जो हमारा नहीं है एक्यूट एपेंडिसाइटिस के लिए आपको वो वाला पेशेंट जो सिंपल एक्यूट एपेंडिसाइटिस वाले जो मैनेज भी हो सकते हैं उनके लिए आपने एक ऐसा क्या इन्फेक्शन डिजीज एक्सपर्ट्स वाले तो कभी आपको अलाउ ही नहीं कर सकते कि आप ऐसे हाई फाई एंटीबायोटिक इस्तेमाल करें इनके डेफिनेटली इंडिकेशन है. अगर कुछ मैं पूछना चाह रहा हूँ कि तो 2019 में खत्म हो चुका था क्या पब्लिश भी किया आपने अपना डेटा पब्लिश
नहीं नहीं
तो आरसीटी भी कर लिया पब्लिश भी नहीं कराया तो फिर और सोचना इतनी अच्छी चीज जो है वो आपकी अपने ऐसी आरसीटी का कोई फायदा नहीं है. दो साल गुजर गए फिर सबमिट कर देना कहेंगे पता जरूरत नहीं है ठीक है ना चीजें कितनी आगे गुजर रही है. सो दिस आर माय इंफॉर्मेशन.
ओके थैंक यू डॉक्टर.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. My name is Dr. Malik Asad Munir. I am working as the Assistant Professor of Pediatric Surgery in my hospital, King Edward Medical University, Lahore. Today I am going to present one of the study that was conducted in my department back in Lahore. That is comparison of outcome of open versus laparoscopic appendectomy in pediatric population. First of all, a little bit about objective. The objective was to compare the outcome of open and laparoscopic appendectomy in the children presenting with appendicitis in terms of operative time, possibility of pain, wound infection, and the hospital stay. Something about methodology, it was a randomized controlled trial done in pediatric surgery department of Mia Hospital Lahore from 1st June 2019 to 30th November 2019. A total of 100 children of age 7 to 12 years of either gender presenting with acute appendicitis having pediatric appendicitis score more than 4 were included. And patient with other comorbidities and perforated appendicitis and appendicular mass and appendicular abscess were excluded. There were two groups. In group A, the patients were undergone laparoscopic appendectomy. In group B, patients were undergone open appendectomy. Data was collected and analyzed regarding total time of surgery of procedure, possibility of pain, wound infection, and the hospital stay in both groups. The post-operative patients of both groups were kept in the ward till discharge. Then the patient were followed up in OPD on the 10th day. Then the results in the study, the mean operative time was 46.68 minutes for laparoscopic appendectomy versus 26.34 minutes for open appendectomy. Mean duration of hospital stay for patient in group A was significantly shorter than the patient in group B. The mean postoperative pain was 2.18 for laparoscopic appendectomy versus 3.50 for open appendectomy, and it was measured by visual analog score of pain. Wound infection was seen in 8% after laparoscopic appendectomy and in 14% after open appendectomy. Rate of conversion from laparoscopic procedure to open procedure was nil, and there was also no foresight injury. In the conclusion, on the basis of our data, we can conclude that in the population presenting with appendicitis, laparoscopic appendectomy is better than the open appendectomy in terms of mean hospital stay, postoperative pain, and wound infection rate.
you very much. Very nice.
Because sir, we have conducted this study in our center because regarding about the 90 we have started the laparoscopy for a long time as Kachishri has joined us as HOD. And he has skills in MIS, so that's why we have conducted this study in our center. So it was a learning curve as well for the PGs, residents and as a junior consultant. So we have excluded initially this kind of patients. Now in the next, as we are learning process, we will include this in the next process.
You got 28% infection with open appendectomy.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is that acceptable?
No, sir, it's not acceptable.
If so why is that with open?
There are many factors, sir. As you know, they are surgery dependent, environment dependent, system dependent. That's why we have that kind of problem.
Scrubbing technique and
there are many things related to surgery.
Kazi Hussain Ahmad Medical Complex, Noshera, experience of the depressive appendectomy.
Most merciful. I'm Dr. Tahir Naeem, and I'm here today to share with you our experience of laparoscopic appendectomy in the pediatric population in order of 209 cases. Here you can see a few real-time images of the laparoscopic appendectomies done in our setup. The main objectives of our study were to determine the role of laparoscopy in pediatric acute appendicitis and to present our and to share our initial experience of 209 cases. This descriptive study was initiated after formal ethical review board approval. The study spanned over a duration of 2 years, and starting in January 2019 till December 2020. We included all patients with acute appendicitis between age 4 and 12, and we excluded patients with contraindication to laparoscopy for any reason. And the total number of patients were 209 during this period, and the variables that were measured were mean hospitalization and complications. And statistical analysis was done via SPSS 25. This here is a graphical representation of the demographics. As you can see, the males accounted for 60% of the patient population and females accounted for 40% of the patient population. And here are the results, but before I report them, I'd like to mention that three of the complications are missing, and I'd like to apologize for that. A total of peritoneal washes were done per operative. Peritoneal washes were done for 12 of the cases, out of which accounted for 5.79% of the total cases. And out of these 12, 7 in 7 cases, phlegmonas appendis was encountered, and in the remaining 5, adherent appendix was encountered. And in all of these 12 cases, there was mild localized contamination, which was proving the peritoneal washes were done. There were no conversions to open, but there were 2 cases of pelvic collection, which were re-explored, and as depicted in the table, there were no cases of visceral injury, or side hernia or infection, and the hospital stay was less than 24 hours following completion of surgery. To conclude my presentation, I would like to say that laparoscopic appendectomy is without a doubt feasible and safe in pediatric patients, although the importance of audit in highlighting and addressing shortcomings cannot be denied. Thank you.
Operating time. In the right upper quadrant versus circumambulical and skin for pyelomyotomy in infantile hypertrophic viral businesses.
I am Dr. Zubair from Children's
comparison of right upper quadrant versus circumambulacral muscle for pyelomyotomy in patients of hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Pyloric stenosis has been treated in past with many surgical approaches, including the right upper quadrant approach, the circumambulacral approach, and nowadays via laparoscopy. The objective of my study is to compare the mean operative time and postoperative hospital stay in patients operated for pyloric stenosis via right upper quadrant and circumambulacral incision. This was a prospective randomized controlled trial, and it was conducted at Children's Hospital Lahore over a period of 1 year from January 2020 to January 2021. The inclusion criteria was the babies who were less than 3 months of age and were diagnosed as cases of pyloric stenosis on ultrasonography, and the patients with other comorbid conditions apart from pyloric stenosis were excluded from the study. And any patients who had intraoperative mucosal injuries or any other intraoperative complications were also excluded from this study. So we added 60 patients, 30 in each group. The first group, group A, included the patients with right upper transverse approach, while the patients in group B were operated via circumambulacral approach. After IRB approval, the parameters like gender, age, operative time and mean post-operative hospital stay were noted, and all the data was analyzed using SKSS23. So in my study, the 30 patients in right upper quadrant group, there were 17 males while 13 were females, and the mean age was 31 plus minus 16.39 days. In circumambulacral group, there were 20 males and 10 females, and the mean age was 23.17 days with a standard deviation of 6.22 days. So this is a small picture of this is the circumambulacral approach, the end result of the circumambulacral incision. This is the supraambulacral circumambulacral, and this is the right upper transverse result. So in my study, we found out that the mean operative time in right upper quadrant approach was statistically significant, and it was lower as compared to the circumambulacral approach. It was 31.7 minutes as compared to 39.6 minutes in circumambulacral approach. But the mean hospital stay after surgery, that was comparable, and there was no statistically significant difference between the two groups. And the p-value for the mean hospital stay was more than 0.05. The post-operative hospital stay was 37 hours in right upper quadrant approach, while 38.3 hours in circumambulacral approach. So to conclude my study, we found in this study that the right upper quadrant approach is superior to circumambulacral approach in terms of having shorter hospital operative time, but it is comparable to circumambulacral approach in having the comparable post-operative hospital stay. Thank you.
Two comments on your presentation. First, why you excluded those who had complications during surgery from your study?
In this study, this particular study, we were not looking after the complications. There is a parallel study in which we did look for the intraoperative and postoperative complications. But then my parameter was postoperative hospital stay. So definitely the patients who had intraoperative complications like mucosal injury or any other complication, they were supposed to be having longer hospital stay after the procedure. So uncomplicated procedures in both groups were included in this study to compare the hospital stay.
But is it possible that complication occurred because of your operation?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And the method you delivered the pyloric tumor?
Definitely, sir.
Because the outcome criteria is very biased. You just include one outcome criteria for judging. There are many other outcome criteria that may give you totally different results.
Definitely, sir. We are working on that, and we have a lot of complications for which we are looking out.
आपकी मर्जी से दो वेरिएबल लेके आप ले लेते मेल फीमेल लेते फिर आप कहते जी मैंने उम्र ले लेते उसकी आप
तो एक स्टडी आप ये बन जाती है, एक आप नहीं बना रही, कल को आप एक कॉस्मेटिक बना रहे हैं तो आप तो पाइथागोरस प्रमेय से पता नहीं कितनी स्टडीज बना लेंगे, ऐसा नहीं होता है। एक ही स्टडी के अंदर सारे वेरिएबल्स इनकॉर्पोरेट होने चाहिए ताकि कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव और एक ओवरऑल पिक्चर जो है नजर आए। आपने कॉस्मेटिक देखा, आपका जो कॉस्मेटिक में पहली जो सर्कम लिक्विड है वो भी आप पैरामीटर बना सकते थे सर, वो नजर नहीं आया हमें यहाँ पे। इसको तो हमें लग रहा है कोई इसमें क्या देखना चाह रहे हैं आप कि अस्पताल में कितनी देर रहा, मरीज को टाइम कितना लगा, तो इसमें तो फिर जान ही पड़ी। दूसरा जो क्वेश्चन आपसे ये कि आपने इतना डेटा प्रेजेंट किया हुआ है, मुझे पता है आप जानते हैं बेटा मानना चाहिए पता कि ये पर आप तो कर रहे हो स्टडीज करना में लैप्रोस्कोपिक वाली, तो आप इतने 60 मरीज इतने सारे मरीज ने क्यों ओपन किए थे? बिकॉज यू हैव बीन लिसनिंग हेयरिंग द डेटा मेनी टाइम, मैंने सुना है कि आप पाइलोरिक स्टेनोसिस मिनिमली इनवेसिव से कर रहे हैं, तो फिर आप क्यों खोल रहे हो?
The aim of our study was to compare ad-libitum feeding and protocol feeding in terms of length of hospital stay and time to achieve goal feed. It was a randomized controlled trial and conducted at Pediatric Surgery Department, Children's Hospital, Lahore, after approval from Ethical Review Committee from December 19 to 2020. Patients included in the study were divided into two groups. The first was ad-libitum feeding group, in which full feed was started once the child was awake and alert, while in protocol feed was gradually introduced in incremental fashion after initial period of NPO, which was 4 to 6 hours. Our variable was mean hospital stay was defined as the length of stay from surgery to discharge, while the goal feed was defined as tolerance of two consecutive full feeds without vomiting. Our data was collected and analyzed by using SPSS version 23. Total 60 patients were divided into two groups. 39% were male and 21% were female. 21 patients were female and the mean weight was 7.76 plus minus 2.12 kg. Regarding the results, we have three parameters. One was post-operative vomiting episodes and which was not significant, and the p-value was more than 0.05 in both groups, but the mean length of hospital stay and the mean time to goal feed was significant in both groups. That was 41.46 in ad-libitum feed, and it was more in protocol feeding, which was p-value was 0.001. While the mean time to goal feed was 20 hours in ad-libitum feeding and 34 hours in protocol feed. So by concluding ad libitum, feeding can be started after pyelotomy instead of complex structured feeding protocols. Ad libitum feeding is safe, has less complications and results in faster recovery and earlier discharge. Early post-operative vomiting has no relationship with the feeding regime, and one should not delay feeding because of it. These are the few references. Thanks to all. Thank you so much.
किस एज के बच्चे आपने अपना प्रेजेंट किया? फॉर लाइक आई सी दैट द मीन एज इज 7.7 केजी है, 7.7 किलोग्राम, 7 किलोग्राम का बच्चा और पाइलोरी स्टेनोसिस है।
जी जी सर।
तो क्या वो किस उम्र पे आ रहे
हैं सर? हमारे पास जो
राजी बच्चे हैं
बड़े सेहतमंद बच्चे आपके पास जानना चाह रहे। दूसरा हम ये कहना चाहते हैं आपकी प्रीवियस स्टडी है उसमें तो उन्हें कोई इशू नहीं हुआ वार्ड स्टे के साथ, उन्होंने तो अगर कोई प्रॉब्लम होती कि इंसिशन से रिलेट कर रहे थे एंड वी डिड नॉट सी, उन्होंने हॉस्पिटल स्टे का जिक्र किया।
सर उनका एक्चुअली उन्होंने कंप्लेंट किया था मेनी द नो टेक्निक्स ऑफ
उनकी स्टडी में भी एक हॉस्पिटल स्टे का वैल्यू था।
जी सर
बट वो तो आपकी वैल्यू जैसा ही है, उसमें तो क्या फर्क
सर? उसमें हमारे में इसमें सर डिफरेंस ये था कि क्योंकि जो प्रोटोकॉल फीड थी उसमें हम फीड जो स्टार्ट कराते थे वो आफ्टर कंप्लीटिंग द एनपी आवर्स देन वी ग्रेजुअली स्टार्ट फ्रॉम पीडियालाइट एंड देन स्टार्ट मिल्क और ब्रेस्ट मिल्क ग्रेजुअली इन इंक्रीमेंटल फैशन। बट इन एड लिबिटम वी स्टार्ट फीड जस्ट आफ्टर द पेशेंट इज वेक एंड अलर्ट, वी स्टार्ट फीडिंग अर्लियर देन द प्रोटोकॉल।
सो आपके पेशेंट कितने घंटे में डिस्चार्ज होकर जा रहे हैं?
सर उसमें मोस्टली पेशेंट जो हमारे डिस्चार्ज होते वो 15 to 20 आवर्स में जो उसका मीन हमारे पास आया। बट फ्यू पेशेंट आर डिस्चार्ज एट 10th और 11th आवर आफ्टर द टेकिंग फीड।
सो स्टैंडर्डाइज्ड फीड इज ऑलरेडी नोन, प्रोटोकॉल्स आर ऑलरेडी देयर इन द लिटरेचर हाउ क्विकली यू कैन स्टार्ट विद द गैस्ट्रिक स्टमक पे सर्जरी एंड डाउन भी खुला हुआ नहीं है। तो these are well defined protocols. Now you're putting the patient randomized control trial, that is my concern here. कि वो एक ऐसी चीज के लिए आरसीटी हो रही है जिसका आंसर पहले से मौजूद है, आरसीटी एक्चुअली एड्रेसेस जिसका आंसर नहीं है एंड यू आर यू हाइपोथेसाइज तो उसका आंसर इस शायद इससे आ जाए, जब आंसर इज ऑलरेडी अवेलेबल और उसे कहीं अर्ली मरीज घर भी जा रहे हैं और आपकी स्टडी में हमने कोई इतनी जल्दी जाते भी नहीं देखा घर, तो फिर तो आरसीटी करना तो मेरा नहीं ख्याल की कोई एक स्टैंडर्ड जो है रिकमेंडेड करके।
थैंक यू।
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Faisal Mahmood Baradzai, resident, post-resident trainee at Faber Teaching Hospital, Peshawar. Today, my topic of presentation is sonographic guided hydrostatic reduction of interoception, its outcome, and its management. Next. What is the objective of my study? To determine the efficacy of ultrasound guided reduction of interception in a term of success rate and to evaluate the impact of factor affecting the outcomes. What is the factor? Bleeding per rectum, palpable abdominal mass, air fluid level on X-ray, duration of symptoms and number of attempts. My study was conducted at Faber Teaching Hospital, which was from June 2019 to June 2020. After taking approval from the Ethical Review Committee Our sample size consists of 55 patients, in which patient was excluded from 3 months to 2 years. Exclusion criteria was to those patient who was containing symptoms, sign and symptom of peritonitis, or radiographic evidence of perforation, previous nephrectomy, or there is any hemodynamic instability. Those patient was excluded. Variables were duration of symptoms, number of attempt and abdominal mass, bleeding per rectum, and air fluid level on X-ray. How we perform this ultrasound-guided hydrostatic reduction? We shift the patient to radiology department. After shifting patient, we take written consent from the patient, and we put after consent, we assisted the patient, and we put a Foley scanner per rectum, and which we connect the fluid, mostly eye fluid. After giving time and fluids, 2 to 3 times we repeat the ultrasound, and after that we evaluate the patient. This is the result of our study which we conducted, in which out of 78, 12% were unsuccessful and 3% were successful. This is the impact of age, gender, and number of attempts on our success rate. Age, mostly we selected the patient from 3 months to 1 year, in which number of patient was 45, in which 37 was successful cases and 8 was unsuccessful. The same 1 to 2 year, in which we selected 10 patient, in 7, 6 was successful and 4 was unsuccessful. The same gender, in which 34 patient we selected, in which 29 was successful, 5 were unsuccessful, and same for the number of attempts. In first attempt, 41, total number of attempts 41, and in 34 was successful and 0 was unsuccessful, and same the second attempt, 14 patient, in which 9 was successful and 5 was unsuccessful. Same the other impact like duration of the symptoms and bleeding per rectum, pulpar abdominal mass, and air fluid level on X-ray, which affect the success rate. In which if the patient is presented to us within 74 hours of symptoms, there were 40 patients which were presented to us within 74 hours, in which 36 were successfully reduced and 4 was unsuccessfully. The same pulpar abdominal mass, bleeding per rectum, and in which the those patients which was presented to us within 74 hours, in which fever was 0.2, which was this was the conclusion of my study. In hemodynamically stable children without sign of peritonitis, hydrostatic reduction is less invasive and effective method of treatment for interception. Below 2 years of age, gender, and number of attempts to reduce interception, palpable abdominal mass, air fluid level on X-ray, and history of bleeding per rectum do not affect the success rate of hydrostatic reduction of interception. However, success rate significantly decreased if the patient present beyond 72 hours of the onset of the symptoms. Thank you.
Thank you.
study that we must appreciate, and coming from Kathapakku Khan, really reducing nearly 80% with hydrostatic is a really success story.
Thank you, Dr. Professor. The next presenter is Majid Arshad from Trevor Teaching Hospital, Peshawar. Hydrostatic reduction of interception in children without ultrasound guidance.
The journey of management of interception started from the surgery performed by Jonathan Hutchinson in the 1871 and traveled to the destination of more sophisticated non-operative treatment of pyrocytic and pneumonia reduction under radiologic guidance, leaving behind the children of limited resources areas deprived of this facility. So he came with the objective to assess the effectiveness and safety of pyrocytic reduction of interception without sonographic guidance in terms of success rate and complication in the limited resources setup and overburdened hospital where sonographic facility is not available around the clock, especially in odd hours. It was a disruptive case series conducted in the pediatric surgery unit KTH Peshawar, initiated in January 2020 and concluded in January 2021. After the approval taken from the hospital ethical committee, total number of 40 sonographically confirmed cases of interception in, meeting the inclusion criteria were more than 6 months and less than 2 years and the symptom duration less than 48 hours underwent unguided hydrostatic reduction and assessed clinically for the successful reduction and confirmed with a chest ultrasound. Here you can see this is how you do it without sonographic guidance, 100 ml per kg of warm saline under UTS and used perfectly. While the patient is monitored throughout the procedure for vitals, abdominal sign and sign of any other complications. Data was statistically analyzed and effectiveness were taken as proportion of cases that underwent unguided successful reduction and confirmed with chest ultrasound, while the safety was taken as proportion of cases who did not develop any sign and symptom of complication or death during or after the procedure. Here are our results. Out of the total 40 patients, 90% reduced successfully, while the 10% did not reduce successfully and underwent the phlebotomy. The age did not affect the success rate, while the impact of duration of symptoms on the success rate was significant as the success rate was high in the patient presenting early since duration of symptoms. As far as the safety was concerned, no complication like vomiting, increased abdominal pain, increased abdominal distension, aspiration, and death were encountered during or after the procedure. And in unsuccessful cases, no perforation found on the phlebotomy in any of the cases. So we concluded that hydrostatic reduction of interception in children without sonographic guidance is effective and safe method in the limited resources setups in overburden hospital where the ultrasound facility is not available around the clock. Furthermore, the success rate was higher in patients presenting early since duration of symptom than those presenting late. So it could be implied that the early unguided reduction done at periphery would be a more good option, better option to avoid unnecessary delay. Hence increases the chances of reduction and decreases the risk of complication as opposed to the delayed attempt for the referral cases to the back centers. Thank you.
Thank you. Very nice presentation. Any questions?
Thank you very much. The next presenter is Noshin Ilyas from Children's Hospital, Rao.
Dr. Noshin, please start his screen sharing so we can continue with your presentation.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. I'm Dr. Noshin Ilyas and I want you to present my study which is a method of setting lollipops on the recovery of state function in children with stoma reversal. Traditionally, we were having oral bleeding till return of normal bowel activity after colorectal surgery. But this may result in post-op IBS, leading to abdominal distension, pain, nausea, vomiting, and delayed return of GID motility.
Dr. Noshin, please directly go to your methodology.
The methodology was experiment randomized control trial from 2nd April 2020 to 1st October 2020 in Children's Hospital and Institute of Child Health, Lahore. My inclusion criteria was children from 2 to 14 years of age undergoing stoma closure and excluded criteria was any patient which was non-compliant to the process. We took a total of 60 patients 30 in each group, and we give lollipop sucking for 20 minutes every 3 to 4 hours, starting at 6 hourly post operatively. My variables were age and recovery time, inundation time, and primary procedure, and I have taken IRB approval from Children Hospital and PTSD Pakistan. Statistical analysis was done during accident version 20. About my results, about recovery time of outcomes, the mean was 25 hours, minimum of 6 hours, and maximum of 72 hours. Patient time mean was 51 hours, and with minimum of 18 hours, and maximum of 144 hours. And among groups, the recovery time of bowel sounds in study group was 16 hours and in control group was 33 hours, and inner defecation time was in study group 33 hours and in control group it was 70 hours. So the conclusion our results of study soon after stoma reversal surgery improves post-op recovery time of GIT function. Patient showed significantly faster recovery of bowel sounds and inner defecation time, and hence length of hospital stay is reduced. This method is simple, convenient, safe, economical, and available to children, and can be recommended for use in similar patient groups. All the thanks to all my other seniors and to the team NICH for giving me the opportunity to present my study. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No questions, so we go for the last presentation.
Dr. Radhika, do you have any placement?
I have audit of the NHSSG in intestinal ecstasy on behalf of Dr. Radhika. Intestinal ecstasy, never included. Demography and details of perioperative events and outcome and follow-up were noted. Descriptive statistics were performed using SPSS 23. Total of 63 patients presented, out of which 37 patients were male and 26 patients were female. Minimum age of presentation was first year of life, and maximum age of child included in our study was 25 days, and mean age of presentation was 5 days. Out of that, 41.3% of patients had type 3 ETGRs, 22% of patients had type 1 ETGR, and rest of the types included 36.7%. Of that, 36% of patients had undergone end-to-end anastomosis, 23 patients had ileostomies, and another 23% of patients had tapering enteroplasty plus end-to-end anastomosis, 11% of patients had Bishop procedure, and 4% had a mucolase ileostomy. Next, please. So the outcome. 15 patients, which accounts for 23.8% of total stable and survived. One patient had failure to thrive due to very proximal stoma, which include 1.6% of patients. We had total 16 in hospital deaths, which accounts for 25.3% of patients, very high. 8 patients lost follow-up, which accounts for 12.6%. And 23 patients were discharged, and on follow-up, they expired, which accounts for 38.5% of the patients. So conclusion. Most common type of ectresia in our study was type 3 intestinal ectresia, and most common procedure then was end-to-end anastomosis with or without tapering. So there is high mortality rate in patients with intestinal ectresia. Thank you so much.
Any questions from? Nothing. Okay. So at last we finished, and are doing very good work around the country, and I was really particularly impressed by the work coming from Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. I don't know whether this was a PTI influence or something else.
Yes.
But I think what we need is probably need more studies, multicentric. And that will give us more idea about how we are doing.